Well, it is good to see you all here this morning. I'm glad you could make it to be with us today and worship the Lord together as a family. I do want to turn your attention this morning to the bulletin. We have a couple of announcements we need to go over. Tonight at 6 o'clock, we're going to be having our evening service, and we will be finishing up the letters to the churches in Revelation. So we're going to be looking at chapter 3, verses 14 through 22. So if you'd like to read ahead, make sure you do that. Please feel free to come, ask questions, and we're learning this together. And also tonight at 6, Common Ground Youth Group is going to be meeting, so make sure you meet upstairs and bring a towel for that. The Quilters are going to be meeting on Thursday from 9 to noon, and this Saturday from 8 to 12, we're having a work bee here at the church. And so if you guys can be here for that, it'll be wonderful. We're going to put together a playground for our kids out here. And I know there's some other things that you've done around the church, so if you guys could come, that's again from 8 to noon on Saturday. We'd love to have you guys here for that. Also, don't forget, immediately following this service at 10 o'clock is our Sunday school program, so if you're here, make sure you stay and check that out. The flowers this week, these beautiful flowers, were donated by Mary Shangrall and Remy of her parents, Albert and Barbara Golden, so we thank you, Mary, for the beautiful flowers. Open house for Cherub's Nest is tomorrow, August 24th, from 6 to 7:30. If you have any questions, you can call the church number there, extension 5. And there's some advertising flyers under the mailboxes in the lobby. Also, you can check out the updated health and safety policy for Cherub's Nest on the church website under the Cherub's Nest tab if you have any questions on what that looks like. Also, we're having our back-to-school potluck lunch. So that's going to be next Sunday, August 30th. If you want to bring a dish to pass, after the second service, we're going to meet in the pavilion, weather permitting. And if not, we'll meet here inside. There is a sign-up sheet on the lobby if you'd like to sign up so we know what people are bringing. Or you can also sign up through the event on Facebook. Under the church's Facebook page, you can sign up through that as well. This Friday night, we're going to be showing Joseph. That will be our drive-in movie. That's going to help us fund with upcoming church projects like the playground and those kind of things. The movie, we ask people to be here by 8:30. The movie will start probably a little closer to 9, but now that it's getting darker earlier, we might be able to start a little closer to 8:30, so please put that on your calendars. And also, if you missed Noah last week, you can meet here in the sanctuary at 2 this coming Friday, and we'll be showing Noah in here on this screen. Also, we're going to do a one-night special. Sight and Sound is putting on their production of Queen Esther, and they will broadcast that live, and we're going to watch that here at the church. And so if you would like to join us, that's September 4th. The program will begin at 7 o'clock, and what you'll be seeing here on the screen will be what is taking place live on stage in Lancaster at the same time. So please put those special events on your calendars and consider coming out and joining the fellowship. As always, if you have any questions on the bulletin, see me after service. I think that's all the announcements I have. Anyone else have an announcement that I forgot or need to make? All right, all in favor say aye. Great, we accept it. Let's move on. Let's stand, open with a word of prayer when we begin our worship service this morning. Father God, you are good. Your love and mercy, they endure forever. And so, Lord, as we meet together today, we ask that you will fill this place with the glory of your love, Lord. The Spirit will move in our hearts in a mighty way. And Father, I pray that we will join together, lift our hearts and voices in a mighty praise of worship. So we bring this offering to you today. Father God, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's praise the Lord together. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty.
This is amazing grace. This is a failing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life, that I would be set free. You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes me orphan, a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice.
pray for those who seek to persecute the church. I want to remind you all that on the back of your bulletin is a list of forget-me-nots, people to pray for, people to write to, contact, our brothers and sisters who need extra prayer. I will, of course, mention today that you will continue to pray for Esther Finch and Cindy Fairchild. She helped to take care of her mother. Esther's is not doing great, and none of us would really be here at Athens Wesleyan without Esther in some part. So continue to pray for them as well. And you see the others who are listed here. God knows the needs. No one goes unnoticed. So as we sing this next chorus, please come and pray. The altars are open. You guys know what to do with the marbles with your request before the Lord. So please come as we sing. Thank you, Lord, for the blood of the Lamb that takes away the sins of the world. This morning, Father, we have lifted some requests before you. You know those that are written upon the page, those that are written upon our hearts, Lord. I pray for Esther especially today, one of the founders of this congregation. Lord, I thank you that you are the God who hears. God who heals. And Lord, you know the plans that you have for Esther today. And I pray that those plans will be accomplished. For your plans, Father God, are perfect. And may your will be done on earth today as it is in heaven. Father, I pray that you will meet the needs of your church, both here in this congregation and across the valley and around the world today. May we not want for the things of the world this morning, but may we seek your kingdom first and foremost above all else. And Father, may you meet the needs of your church. May you stir those coals that have grown cold. Rekindle that fire within us, Father God. We are reminded this morning, oh, how you love us. How we need to love you. So, Father, as we continue in our worship today, I pray that you will not only be with us here in this place, but that you will fill us with the Spirit in a mighty way. And, Lord, that as we go from here today, you will give us opportunities to minister and to shine the light that you have provided for us into this world of darkness around us. Father, may we be your hands and feet. And now, Lord, as we continue in our worship this morning, I pray that your will continue to be done. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. If our ushers would come at this time. Let us pray. Father God, we give these tithes and offerings to you. We bring them into the storehouse, Lord, and we entrust them to your care. These are not ours, Lord, but merely a portion of that which you have provided for us. And so, Lord, take these that we bring. Bless them and multiply them, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, I'm going to play a song that, I guess, in honor of my Grammy. I sang this with her on Tuesday last week when I was down there, and I sing it to my kids about every night. So, this is The Meeting in the Air. You have heard of little Moses in the bulrush. You have heard of fearless David and his sling. You have heard the stories told of dreaming Joseph and of Jonah. There are many, many others through the Bible. I'd like to meet them all, I do declare. By and by the Lord will let us meet them at that meeting in the air. Oh, there's going to be a meeting in the air, in the sweet, sweet by and by. I am going to meet you over there. At home beyond the sky, such singing you will hear, never heard by mortal ear, will be glorious, I do declare. And God's own Son will be the leading one at that meeting in the air. Many things there will be missing in that meeting, for the mourner's bench will have no place at all. There will never be a sermon preached to sinners, for the sinner had refused to heed the call. There will be no mourning over wayward loved ones, all our burdens and our... There will be no mourning over wayward loved ones. There will be no lonely nights of pleading prayer. All our burdens and our anguish will be lifted at that meeting. By and by, I am going to meet you over there, in that home beyond the sky. Such singing you will hear, never heard by mortal ear, will be glorious, I do declare. And God's own Son will be the leading one at that meeting. One more song this morning. I believe this song is appropriate today. A good reminder that our God, in the midst of all this chaos, remains indescribable.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the colors.
Now, what's interesting about this story that Jesus tells is that it may or may not be fictional. When we look at all the parables that Jesus has told, he never names the characters. And yet here, we see this one named Lazarus. So there's a possibility that this very well may be true. And so take careful caution when reading. Again, this is Luke chapter 16, verse 19. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, "Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue because I am in agony in this fire." But Abraham replied, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us." He answered, "Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them." "No, Father Abraham," he said, "but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent." He said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced even if someone rises from the dead." We're going to stop there. Lazarus and the rich man. This is not the same Lazarus who was raised from the dead. Okay? You can imagine Lazarus was their version of Larry, a common name. Okay? But here we have this great divide between the rich and the poor. And in their culture, there was a very clear and distinct barrier between the two classes. But yet that divide could have been gapped so easily while living. All the rich men had to do was give Lazarus some scraps and bandage his wounds. And yet now, while they are separated for eternity, the chasm is too wide to cross. It's a sad account. I had someone arguing with me one time about hell being fictional and all this, and I pointed him to this passage of scripture. I said, "So why would Jesus specifically mention hell if it were not real?" "Well, I think he was just trying to prove a point." I said, "You telling me you think that the Son of God, creator of heaven and earth, has to create some idea of something that does not exist to prove his point?" In the book of Matthew, Jesus himself mentions hell 7 times. We look at 2 Peter. He talks about this place where the angels who have fallen are placed. They are held in these gloomy dungeons, he calls them, until the time of the judgment. I'm sure that many of you have heard somebody say, "Well, I don't believe that God would send anybody to hell." And I can agree with that. I don't believe that God will send anybody to hell. But he will accept your choice you so choose to go there. You see, hell was not designed for human beings. This place of torment, as it is called here by the rich man, was never meant for human beings. Hell, as we see in Scripture, was designed for Satan and his angels. Lucifer, as Isaiah calls it, this light bearer, right? The brightest, the most brilliant, the most beautiful of all the angels, and yet he wants to have more power than God. Jesus said, I saw him fall like a lightning bolt. God does not desire any of his children should go to hell. And I have a hard time believing that some people were created just to go to hell. Why would God send his only begotten Son to die, not to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved, if his desire was to see some people go to hell? And this is where free will comes in. We have to choose. The rich man knew of Lazarus. He lived at his gate. He knew what he was supposed to do. As a wealthy man at that time, he was probably also an educated man. And in their culture, every Jewish boy was taught the scriptures. He knew the Ten Commandments. He knew the prophets. He knew Moses and Abraham. And yet he was more concerned about his earthly affairs and his earthly status than he was about helping the man dying at his gate. He was living the Jerusalem dream. Dressed in fine clothes, purple. Purple was the color of royalty. Because there's only one place on earth at the time you could buy purple cloth. It's not that it was hard to make. You just couldn't find it anywhere else. So here is a man who considers himself royalty, right? He's dressed in these fine colors. Look at me. Look at my splendor. Think of a peacock, right? The big old tail flops up and all those vibrant colors start flashing around. And he was so high and mighty, he couldn't stoop to feed those who had nothing right outside of his walls. He made a conscious decision to ignore the needs that God had placed directly in front of him. See, sin is not just something we do wrong, right? That's the sin of commission. It's a sin that we commit. Sin is also something we don't do that is right. That's the sin of omission. We leave it off. Well, I don't like that, so I'm not going to. That's the rich man. He chose to ignore where God had placed him. He chose to ignore the needs that God had surrounded him with. Instead, he hoarded his wealth. He chose to honor himself in this life. But we see when the time came for them to die, the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. When Lazarus, this poor beggar, covered in sores, whose only friends and constant companions were the dogs who would come to lick his wounds, was carried to Abraham's side, to paradise, to peace, by angels, these messengers of God. And the rich man died and was buried. You see the contrast there? The one that the world looked at as nothing was carried by angels to Abraham's side, personally escorted there. And yet the rich man, when he died, in hell, where he was tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away. He is not at peace. He is in hell. It is a physical place. The word here in the Greek is Hades. It is like Gehenna in the Hebrew. It means this place of the dead, right? This grave. So imagine, if you will, this kind of holding area with fire that burns but does not consume. Anybody ever get burnt before? Like more than just, ow, I touched a hot pot, right? It hurts for a long time, and it disfigures if it's bad enough. But this fire only causes pain and does not consume. It is a place of torment. And I think one of the worst torments here is that he is able to look to Abraham's side and see where he could have been and be reminded of the choices he made and how he failed to heed the warnings. And now he is in a place that is separated from anything good. He can't even get a drop of water on his tongue. He cries out, "Abraham, help me. Send Lazarus," right? "My only constant companion, whom I ignored my whole life. Send him here." How selfish. Even in torment and agony as he is, he desires for that poor beggar to come here where I am to be tormented so that he can give me some relief. Abraham says, "Sorry about your choices, bud. Tried to warn you." And the torment continues. "We'll send him to my father's house. My brothers don't wind up here." Can't do that. And now this rich man has to live with the knowledge that he failed to reach those that were closest to him. I use the word "live" there with a purpose. This shows us that life after death exists. The physical body will break down and stop, yes, but you will continue to live. Your soul is eternal. It will continue to live on even once the body dies. This is not the place where we are called to go. As I said last week, our place is for eternity. We were created for eternity with God. That's been his plan the whole time. God created all the heavens and the earth. But he wanted Adam. He wanted that companion. He wanted to be in the presence of Adam and vice versa, so they could fellowship together and they could learn and grow. That was his desire for humanity. And he brings that full circle. But if we choose, "Lord, I don't want anything to do with you here on this earth for 80 years, 90 years, 100 years, God says, "That's okay, I won't force you to live with me for eternity then. If you can't stand me for a few years, you'll never make it for eternity." And so he honors that decision. So there's no gray area. There's, contrary to some teachings, there's no purgatory where if you're mostly good, you can go and get those extra sins burned off. Then you can go to heaven. No, it's one or the other. One moment after death, you're going to stand before the throne of God. And you've got one of two choices. But at that moment, the choice has already been made. That's why we never know what the next heartbeat may hold. This is why it is so important. And the purpose of Jesus talking about hell is not to say, "Oh, well, shame on you guys, you awful sinners. You need to get this right, but this is where you're going to go." This is not like your mom saying, "You just wait till your father gets home," to scare you into being good, right? No, he's saying, "Look, there is another option." He's being fully honest. "This is where you were designed to go. This is where I created you for. This is why I love you, and this is why I came, so that you could be here in heaven with us forever and ever and ever, and it's going to be awesome and perfect, and I will wipe away the tears from your eyes myself." But if you choose that, this is the other option. All right? The Bible says much more about heaven than it does hell. But it is important that we know the other side of the coin. turn back now to Revelation. Chapter 20, verse 11. Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. Now this comes right after Satan's doom. Satan is destroyed, he's thrown into the lake of burning sulfur. The beast and the false prophet have been thrown, they will be tormented day and night forever and ever and ever. Right? That is where he belongs. That is where he will be. And then we look at verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne, and him who was seated on it. Earth and sky fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Great white throne. This is the throne of judgment. This is not the cosmic hippie Jesus full of love, full of peace, and he just wants to make your life so much better. This is God the judge, sorting out the sheep from the goats, just as Jesus said in Matthew. Books are open. What kind of books? Record books. Do you have a book in heaven that has your name on it? And in that book are recorded your deeds. You are judged according to your deeds. And if your name is not found written in the book, which book? The official citizen law of heaven. Right? If your name is not in the citizenship of heaven, you're not getting into heaven. And those whose names are not found there will also be thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death. This is hell as we think of it. A lake of eternal fire. Anyone whose name is not found written in the book. Is your name in the book today? That's the question. As I said last week, heaven is our goal. He goes on, you get a little paragraph here, right? Satan's doom and the dead are judged. If you're not in the book, you go to hell. But the rest of the book is about the glory of God and heaven coming down. That, again, is the most important. That is where we as Christians are going. Those who have been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, who have had our sins forgiven and washed clean, those aren't in the book anymore. Well, Lord, I did all those bad things. Well, I don't see them here. All I see is a blood stain. But I did, but all this, I don't know what you're talking about. You've been erased. So, welcome home. And yet there are some in the church that stand before God. Got this. Chapter 1. Uh-oh. It is not our works that save us from hell. It is only the blood of the Lamb. But as I have said so many times throughout this series, our purpose is to do these good works which Christ has prepared in advance for us to do. Don't be like the rich man. Don't have all the knowledge and wealth of the world at your fingertips and fail to reach your neighbor. Consequences are disastrous, church. I don't crazy lunatic. They already think that, so that's okay. But because it is my responsibility as your pastor to tell you about both options. And not making a choice means the choice has already been made for you. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, each and every one of us. Thanks be to God, for we are each justified freely through the blood of Jesus Christ. There is not an excuse for us to go to hell. There is no reason for it. All the good intentions in the world will not save you. You must be born again. For God loved the world so much, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. God loves you so much. He loves you so much more than you will ever, ever begin to fathom. He provided a way for you. A clear way that cost you nothing. Because Jesus has paid it all. Will you trust him today, church? Will you trust him? Will you turn from your wicked ways and sin no more, that he may pour out his Spirit upon you and wash you in the blood of Jesus Christ? Will you allow him to do that, to keep you from hell? Not to scare you into doing it, but because you believe he loves you so much, he sacrificed his Son to keep you. Do not make the sacrifice in vain. Christ died for you. Think on that this week. Christ died for you. Give thanks to him. Be glad. You don't have to go to hell. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, usually at this time we would have some music and sing a song. I did not feel that that would be appropriate today. Instead, in the quiet of our hearts, Lord, may we listen for your call. Take off our blinders, Lord. Take off the earplugs that the world has placed in our ears. Lord, clear the way to our heart, that we may not be like this rich man. We are the wealthiest, most prosperous people who have ever lived upon the face of the earth. And yet, Lord, we are spiritually dead if we are not in Jesus Christ. Search our hearts today, Father God. Know us. See if there's any wicked way within us, Lord. Set us free. Father, even if we have turned away,